record is the darkest we've ever been, it's the lightest we've ever been, and it's the hardest and the softest. It's kind of everything. What we try to capture on this record is sounds very cheesy, but I think it's life. It's everything in life. I mean, it's one big sort of movement through time and through emotion.
It's hard to say if there's a real narrative behind the record. It's kind of like the horror films that work the best are the ones where you never really see the monster, because your own mind is so much, it's so much more capable of frightening yourself than any image could ever be, you know. So we can sort of speak to people's own subconscious somehow. We wanted this record to be more like one big body of work, you know. And from having toured a lot with the last record, we started noticing that the songs we really enjoyed playing live and really still enjoyed listening to a lot were the ones that really changed direction in within the song, you know, where you don't really know where the song is going to end and you might not have so much repetition in the song.
The idea to have a record as almost a whole, as a kind of one movement record, it stems from us looking at the work we've done before and seeing what are the qualities that we really appreciate in our music. And I think some of the qualities are very well represented in a song like Am I Rhino, which is the opening track off our last record.
I think the reason why our music has become more complex and more progressive, if you will, is has more to do with just a simple curiosity about music, a will to sort of expand our horizon a little bit, you know.
Apocalypse was one of the first things that we wrote for the record, and it was just a beginning of a little sign, for example, that Silas, who is a drummer of our band, is one of the greatest drummers, I think. He makes drum patterns like, you know, great guitar riffs, you know, and I think that riff for me is a big part of the song. And I had written something on the guitar, and it just seemed like a powerful place to start.
Apocalypse, I thought, was a pretty good first single because it did have some of the elements of the last record, the sort of very sort of big and spatial parts, as well as a very intricate guitar riff. But it is a little harder than anything we've done before. I thought it was a good wake-up call for people hearing it for the first time as well. Special is about a relationship, I guess, and it's a bit dark. We got sent a lot of video treatments for Special, and somehow they all had to do with like cheerleading girls and, you know, stuff like that, and this treatment was very different.
I think the reason why we chose to work with Martin Detour, who did the video, was that his
you know, vision of the video and vision of the song was so offbeat compared to what we had in mind. And, you know, we always seen it as a bit of a disco ditty, you know, a sort of a dirty track. And here he came and said, you know, I want to do this really sort of slow pace, very gracefully, black and white, you know. And we were just like, okay, that's so far off what we were thinking, so that might just be genius, you know.
Dinosaur Jr. was playing Copenhagen, and I was walking down the main street, and who's like main shopping strip Copenhagen, who comes like tall with me, it's Jay Maskus. So I go up to him and say, oh, that's weird, man, I'm gonna see the show tonight, and blah blah. So we start talking a little bit, and he's like, yeah, I'm out shopping, you know, I lost my suitcase, you know. Well, he didn't have any money, so I lent him a few quid, and then, you know, he gave me a guest list. I could just wrote all my friends in the guest list for the night show. And I went down there and he gave me the money back. And then we thought, you know, we should ask him to sing on the record because we always have a guest appearance.
His voice was such a great contrast to my voice, I thought, basically. And that my voice is very high and his is kind of dark and raspy. And on the last record, we had a duet with a 12-year-old girl. And he was kind of the opposite of that.
We didn't deliberately try to be clever about it and say, hey, let's get this great guitar player and let's have him sing in his funny voice. You know, we all really love his voice.
We have a guitar player that is, I mean, if not at least as good as Jay, so we didn't need a guitar solo there.
The visuals that we make for the live show always come after we've made the music. Usually what I do is I sit down and listen to the finished music and then I'll have images appear in my head. Sometimes even before we record the songs, but the music really inspires the visuals.
I mean, we like to play with a lot of different, like, how do you say, sound and visuals and lights and all. Instead of, I mean, we have the, I mean, ability to bring all those aspects in to a live show, and that's what we're doing. And sometimes it can get a bit boring just watching a concert and watching people with just playing and sweating.
I hope that when people go see us, that they really find it very inspiring. I hope they feel that the music recognizes something in them, because I think that's really what music does for me. If there's a piece of music that I like, it's because I feel like it has something in it that I can recognize from myself, but I haven't really been able to put it into words or music before, but that this kind of, you know, solves it for the first time.
Mew.
Fantastic band.
Really world class.
Yeah.
Mew was really world class. It was something very, it reminded me a little bit of Bloody Valentine, which is one of my favorite bands. It's very, very, very cool.
I think it makes good sense to say that is a little Mew world, and hopefully it's a very compelling place, so you would want to be a part of it, but it's also a place that's a little bit difficult to enter, and a little bit, you have to sort of
yeah, you have to make an extra effort, I think, to be a part of it. And that can, you know, seem appealing to a lot of people, hopefully.